There is just one word that I want to say with regard to the procedure adopted by the UK government. I do not wish in the least to complain because I am fully aware of the difficulties which confronted the UK government in this matter, because one of the matters which I presume ultimately led to this decision of the UK government was that because of these wild rumors floating about the world, there was a vast movement of sterling from the UK to other countries, and probably events compelled them to act in the way they did. They were faced with a very difficult and a very delicate situation. I make the fullest allowance for that fact. Nevertheless, I feel that if arrangements had been considered in time, it would have been possible for the UK government to take the Commonwealth ministers more fully into their confidence than they apparently did. I say that for this reason, that in the Commonwealth Ministers' Conference, which was convened for the very purpose of discussing the dollar situation, there was no reference whatever to the subject of devaluation, and if, as I understood it, the resolution passed by the Commonwealth Ministers Conference provided that brief for the Washington talks, then the decisions reached at Washington by the representatives of the UK government, in my opinion, exceeded the brief that the Commonwealth ministers gave the British Chancellor of the Exchequer. I cannot help thinking that in a matter which so vitally affects the whole economy of every country in the sterling area, steps should have been taken to arrange for a secret meeting of the finance ministers of the Commonwealth countries before this decision was sprung upon them regarding three matters: the need for devaluation, the extent of devaluation, and the time of devaluation. I am quite aware of this, that any such conference would have intensified the rumors that were already floating about, but if I had been in Sir Stafford Cripps' place, what I would have done would have been something like this. Here was the Washington conference discussing this matter on the brief prepared by the Commonwealth Ministers' Conference. It could have been arranged that a report should be made by the Chancellor of the Exchequer to the Commonwealth Ministers' Conference of the results of the talks which he held on the brief we prepared. But that could have been made the ostensible object of the conference. Incidentally, it would have enabled Sir Stafford Cripps to acquaint us really with the circumstances that led to this final decision. Let me say again that I make this statement because I feel we have been placed in a position which led not merely to inconvenience to ourselves but also inconvenience to our neighbors, Sri Lanka and Pakistan, and I think every effort should have been made to avoid the inconvenience that was caused in that way. Now I proceed to tell the House what precisely are the reasons which led us to take the decision we did. I want to make it perfectly clear that although I feel logically on the basis of economic facts, there was a case for devaluation both of the pound sterling and of the rupee. I should have liked to face this problem and to come to my decision regarding the problem after a good deal of more deliberation than I was allowed time for. I feel that in this matter I have had to act not on conviction born of logic necessarily, but so to speak by the compulsion of events. I am not happy that I have had to make a decision in those circumstances. Nevertheless, since the pound sterling was devalued, I felt and my colleagues entirely agreed with me that there was no other course open to us. I say that for this very good reason, nearly 75% of the export trade of this country is with the countries in the soft currency areas. Therefore, when sterling was devalued, if we did not devalue, the result would have been that our export trade to these countries would not merely have greatly diminished, but in course of time in certain important directions might have been wiped out altogether. Lancashire peace goods competing with our peace goods in the markets of the sterling area, Sri Lanka, tea competing with our tea in the same area, East African groundnuts competing with our groundnuts, South African manganese competing with our manganese, and so on. The position was really serious and we could not afford to take the risk involved in keeping the value of the rupee at a higher rate when it was likely to lead to these extremely grave consequences for the country. It is not merely that our export trade would have suffered the dwindling of our export trade would straightway have reacted upon our import for trade, because the only way in which we can pay for our imports is by earning foreign exchange by our exports to the Western countries.